almost said good morning like all of you were doing all day. Awesome. Well, it's great to be together with everyone. You guys sound incredible. What phenomenal singing. Well, I hope you're ready for God's word here today. We're going to get on into the lesson here. And also, please be praying. Our dear sister Kiss had a pulmonary attack earlier in the service. And a bunch of us had to be out there with her, and the ambulance just came and took her to the hospital. So be keeping her in your prayers. Amen. Even in wanting to go to the hospital, she would not let them take her until she was able to take communion. Because that's just her heart. So, amen. The title of today's lesson is Let There Be Light. Words from Heaven. Words from Heaven. Of course, the bulletin from today ties together with the lesson. As does the handout, because our words make an impact. And the way that the lesson on Assyria ties in is that we often go to the place of Assyria because of what people say to us and how it impacts us. And so that is geared to help us through that today. Amen. You can be turning in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. I want you to consider these words. Let there be light.
Come on, Rob. All right,
Rob. Those were the first words spoken by our Father in heaven. And yet, no one who's ever heard these words has ever forgotten them.
All right.
Because God's word makes a lasting impact in our lives. And yet you, sitting here today, are made in the image of God. Every word you speak makes impact, good or bad. Every word you speak creates something. And see, our words are either from God or they're from us. They either build up or they tear down. Our words justify us or they condemn us. And our words either unify us with those around us or they divide us from those around us. And with that, I want you to have the understanding today. You have power with the words that you speak. See, with our words, at one point we didn't have a sound crew here in Southland. And now we have one. We didn't just say, hey guys, and we had sounds. There were words spoken involved in training. You know what I'm talking about? And so our words actually create. They create the sound crew that we have. And we have an incredible sound crew. Are they not doing an incredible job? Our words teach and train and create ushers who greeted you when you came through the door. And are they not doing a fabulous job? Even while we're sitting here taking in the service and all the things going on, they're still buzzing around working. And yet our words create awesome, incredible Bible talks that pull people in and give them hope that they can read the Bible and understand it. Our words create Bible talks. They create churches. And they create movements around the world that change this world for Jesus Christ. The funny thing about our words is that we can say 100 right and proper words and then bring it all down with one careless and reckless word. And yet, that's why God looks out for us here in this first passage we're going to read. Turn to Matthew 12. See, God looks out for us with commands that protect us from us. You know what I'm saying right there? Matthew chapter 12. We're going to begin in verse 36. I was feeling the pressure today. Everybody that came up here like did a song or sang a song, and I was like, sorry, I ain't singing for nobody. That's just not my thing, you know? Amen. That's why God gave me my beautiful wife Tracy to move my heart like that. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, Jesus says, but I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Wow, that's a sobering passage. Like, I don't have to like go, oh, do you have wow in your word? I don't even have to do that because the scripture just does it on its own right there. You know what I'm saying? And yet, we're judged by our words. So often we can forget that we're judged even with our words that are in reaction to someone hurting us. God still expects those words to be righteous and proper and built up.
Come on.
How challenging it is to do that though, right?
Yeah.
Anyone never done that? Everyone never like chewed somebody out? That's great. Mario raised his hand. He's a liar. So, and then we all did it. No. We see, we're all in a level playing field in that way.
Yeah.
That we've all lost our cool.
Yeah.
And yet, so we must remain sober and reliant on the Holy Spirit so we speak His words when we're hurt, not our words.
Yeah.
Literally, from our words, with no joke, no pomp, no propaganda, with our words, we can literally change this world.
Yeah.
Speaking is an action.
Wow.
It's something you choose to do.
Yeah.
And you're fully responsible for every word that comes out before God. And you're responsible for the outcome of what you say. So we either learn to do it well and things go awesome for us, or we don't and things don't go well for us. See, our words is what makes us righteous or wise or wicked and a fool. Now here's the funny thing. What you say and what you don't say speaks.
Wow.
You know what I'm talking about?
Come on, Ryan. Hello.
See the look on your face? It speaks.
Oh, yeah.
Your body language? It speaks.
Oh, yeah.
Oftentimes, the words that we speak are nothing compared to the nonverbal things that we speak. And you know, like everything in the Bible, God wants you to be hot or cold. You know what I'm saying? And yet, today I want you to make a decision. I want you to make a decision. To speak words that are cool and healing to the soul. I want you to decide today to be that person who will change the world by ridding yourself of words that hurt and divide.
Amen.
See, here's the funny thing. I've been a disciple for 24 years. And I came into the church, like all of us, hurt, devastated, angry, bitter, all kinds of things. I had great moments in my life. I had awesome things that happened. But when it came to my interactions with people, I was just a little prickly. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so, like the first time I came, it was a big service. It was like 3,000 people at the service I came to. And this guy came up and he just gave me this big old hug. He's like, hey, bro. I was like, dude, I'm freaking killing you right now. Get off me! And I was like, oh, I don't like to be touched. And I'm going to have an account for those words when I get up there, you know? And yet, we come to church, and even people that speak professionally come in terrible communicators. See, we're victims of ourselves thinking we're victims of others. And here's the thing, it doesn't matter what we intend to do with our words. It only matters the outcome of how it turns out after our words come out. There's some great quotes that I read that I thought were awesome. One's by John Billings. This says, the best time for you to hold your tongue is the time you feel you must say something or burst. Benjamin Franklin said, better slip with the foot than the tongue. And then I love this one, Frank Tigre. He says, there is no evidence that the tongue is connected to the brain. And the one real question I will ask of you today is, on a general basis, how do people typically feel after they speak with you? Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. See, there's a reason why it's fair for God to judge us in any moment, at any moment in time in our life. Because everything, wherever you're at, in your relationships, in your job, in your life, in every area, is a result of your choices and your words. And so it's fair for God to judge us. You know, I was sitting out there with Jennifer and with Kiss and with Talisha, and Kiss has this terrible disorder where she literally can't breathe. And she was suffocating literally right in front of us. And wow, that's sobering. And you could just see the terror on her face that this might be her moment.
Yeah.
And wow, I was so moved. I had to go leave and take a walk and cry a little bit. Because she's like a daughter to us. We love her so dearly. And yet, it made me realize the importance of this lesson.
Yeah.
She's trying to write things. I need to take communion and wanting to make sure she's right. That she's taken account for herself and what she said and what she's done. And yet, when we don't have that sense that today could be it, we let so many things fly out of our mouths.
Yeah.
That if it was our last moment, would never come out.
Yeah.
I want to ask you to live in that place.
Yeah.
Live in that place where today is the last day and your words reflect that. In Ephesians 4, verse 29, God gives us an incredible standard here. He says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only... Wow, he just narrows it on down right there. But only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that in it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit with which you are sealed for the day of redemption. And he goes on to say, get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger and malice. Well, you know, God doesn't tell us to do something that we're not capable of doing. And so that means you have inside of you the power to be able to rid yourself of all bitterness.
Wow. Yeah.
To rid yourself of all anger, yeah. Of all rage. You don't have to think about the things that have been done to you in your life.
Yeah.
And when you access that power that's inside of you, and you put all those things away... The things you say will pave the way for a great life for you. But if you say, I just don't want to deal with it now, oh, the road is going to be very rough for you. See, God calls us to safe, wholesome conversation. Now, here's the funny thing. This is the thing that we don't forget. But I need to say what I need to say. And God's word makes it so you can say anything and everything that you want to say. There are no restrictions. So whatever you're feeling, whatever's going on with you, you can say it. You just have to stop yourself, access the power of the Holy Spirit, and say it like God would say it. But we're too lazy-minded to really think through our words that much. Except in super extreme, drastic situations where we feel humbled. And yet we're supposed to live humbly all day long so we can live like that in our speech. See, the words of disciples of Jesus should compel the people of this world to want to be like us. That in the toughest of times, our speech is filled with grace and with mercy and with love. So that they want to know our God. Our first point today is simply the phrase, what comes out of a man?
Wow.
Go to Matthew chapter 15.
Okay.
What comes out of a man?
Oh,
and I'm not leaving you sisters out.
Right.
The Bible says, man, talking about mankind. In Matthew chapter 15, beginning in verse 10. What comes out of a man? Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen and understand. What goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean." Isn't that interesting? So much focus on what we eat and what we do and all those things, and yet God says what goes into your mouth isn't what makes you unclean. But what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean. Then the disciples just had a few questions, because even though that sounds very simple, it wasn't simple. It says, then the disciples came to him and asked, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this?" He replied, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them. They're blind guides. If a blind man leads a blind man, they will both fall into a pit." Well, it's an interesting thing. How does a blind man lead a blind man? With his words.
Yeah.
And so when you follow somebody whose words are wicked, you fall into the same pit that they fall into. And then, of course, that wasn't enough. So Peter said, "Okay, explain this parable to us." And I love Jesus' response. You would think, like, these words are crazy. "Are you still so dull?" It's like, what is wrong with you? You don't get this? They're like, "Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth and goes into the stomach and out of the body, but the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart. And these make a man unclean. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, and slander. These are what make a man unclean." But eating with unwashed hands does not make him unclean. But you should still wash your hands. Amen, guys? Amen. Amen. See, just like, why did Jesus use this? Because just like food that goes into our stomach, that's not clean, that shouldn't be in there, once it sits in there for a while, you get sick.
Yeah.
And then what comes out, it's bad, it's nasty. Yeah. And so the same way, when we see vomit, we're like, ugh. It's what comes out of our mouths that make people around us go, ugh. Because it's unclean, because there's been stuff sitting in there not dealt with. So, turn to Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs chapter 18. And of course, the best place, I believe, in the scriptures to learn how to speak appropriately is Proverbs. And you know, we get this thing about us as human beings. Like, because we speak every day, I know what I'm doing. And yet, people have babies every day. They don't know what they're doing, but they have them and they just do their best, you know? And we get offended when people try and tell us to do something that we do every day, because we do it every day, so why are you telling me what to do?
Come on.
And yet, we can have so much conflict in our lives. So many problems, so many challenges, and not yet see what's the common denominator.
Yeah.
I was having a conversation with a guy on Friday, and we just weren't seeing eye to eye. And he was like, "Why are you not understanding me?" And I was like, "Well, why are you not understanding me? What I'm saying is so simple." He's like, "Exactly, what I'm saying is so simple." And we just could not get eye to eye. And I ratcheted through like all my relationships, and I went, you know what? I have three other people that simple things like this matter, I just have a challenge with. And all three of these people have the same exact personality, and I have the same challenge with all three. What's the common denominator? Me. So I was like, I need a moment, because I am having a challenge with you that I'm having with a few other people the same exact way. And you're right, this should be simple. And now I feel stupid, so I'm going to go pray and come back. And then let's talk again. And I came back, and he was gracious enough to give me a few minutes to go pray. And then when I came back, it was an amazing thing. I took ownership, I saw I was the common denominator, and then it got fixed like just like that. And yet so many of us, because we're hurt, just dig our heels on in. And no, you're going to understand me. When the Bible says what you're supposed to say is helpful for them. And that becomes the issue in our lives. You know what I'm saying?
Come on.
And Hebrews 12:15 says a bitter root grows up. See, what sits inside of us become bitter. And then it comes out. You can't control it. We're going to talk about that in the next point.
Amen.
And yet, I put before you today, it takes mental, emotional, and spiritual strength to speak in such a way as to have a victorious life.
Wow.
But what is it that comes out of a man? Well, you know, for me, I have to say my childhood has affected my life greatly over the years. And I grew up and I had my mom and my dad in my home. And yet there was abuse and there was adultery and there was different things going on in the home that were not good. Now, all these things are like fixed now, which is great. But, you know, I grew up where my dad put me in the hospital several times in his anger. And with my mother several times, the same thing. I was taken with him to the adulterous settings and then beaten if I talked. It was a very challenging childhood. And yet, you know, I'm really grateful my sister's here with us today. Wonderful to have you here. And yet, my dad, who I love with all of my heart, was not there for her growing up either, or my other sister. And yet, I met my sister when I was 21 years old for the first time. And it was so challenging. But what that did is I'm still responsible to deal with it. See, I'm responsible to get rid of all bitterness, all rage, all malice, all slander, all of it. Or else now that thing's ruling my life.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
And yet, it affected the way I spoke. I could not speak words from heaven because I would not deal with me here on earth.
Wow.
I don't know if you've ever been there. See, the problem is a phrase that I learned several years ago. Hurt people, hurt people. Are you hurt? There's no way you can keep from hurting people when you are hurt. Because it will just come out of you. Instead, you must deal with the hurt. And the only way to deal with the hurt of deep waters is through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Knowing he died for you. Knowing he sacrificed himself for you. That is the only way to get through that. People pay thousands of dollars for counseling, thousands of dollars for self-help seminars. They fly all over the world, and yet the answer is right there. The answer is right there. It's always been right there. Well, all religions are all kind of the same. Yeah, they all are, because they all started from Adam. All races came from Adam. Why would you think all religions didn't stem from there as well?
Wow.
And then they got so bad he wiped them out. And then they all came from Noah. And then as they spread all over the earth, you had unfaithful generations that didn't follow the same teaching. And so you got some of the teaching, a hybrid of a rebellious person that didn't really want to do it.
Yeah.
Thus you have all the religions of the world.
Yeah. Right.
And yet, I think about the way my relationship with my father ruled my life.
Yeah.
Any man who spoke in any way even close to the way my dad spoke to me got my wrath. Nobody's going to talk to me like that ever again. I made him stop, and I'll make any other man stop. That was where I was at. So I could not resolve conflict with anyone because I let it rule. And yet, now today, my father and I talk every couple of days. I see him, I hug him, we kiss. We have a very close relationship. How did we get there? Jesus saved me. That's how. It's that simple. He wasn't going to change. Thank God, God saved me and changed me. Oh, I'm not taking credit. I didn't change. God changed me. See, my sister met me when I was 21 at my worst. and I know she's going to recall, every sentence was a cuss word. Didn't matter if I was angry or sad, didn't matter. I cussed all the time.
Wow.
And, you know, her and her fiance at the time came into America to live, and he's a motorcycle guy, and of course I had a motorcycle. And so we'd just go buzzing down the street, 130 miles an hour on Jamboree Avenue in Irvine. And no helmet, no, just shorts, tank top, just ready to die. Literally. I didn't care, because I was so angry, I no longer cared about dying. So why would I care about my words and if they inflicted hurt or not? I was just letting anybody have it that looked like they were going to give it to me in some way. And yet then Jesus saved me.
Come on.
From one day, I did a study about the Word of God that talked about the wholesome talk. And since that day, I can count, it's been five times I've said a cuss word since that day.
Wow.
Because Jesus' power changed my life in that way. But before that, what came out of me was me. My past.
Yeah.
My hurt.
Yeah.
My dad.
Yeah.
I mean, I met my sister, and I couldn't even be super happy that I met my sister. I was mad at my dad that I never met my sister.
Yeah.
What the heck? What is that? It's what we do as human beings when we don't deal with what's happening with us. See, what comes out of us determines our future. But also what comes out of us can shape this world to being exactly what Jesus called it to be.
Come on, bro.
Secondly, let's go to the book of James.
All right.
Book of James, chapter 1.
Oh, yeah.
Our second point, words on fire.
Woo.
Words on fire. James chapter 1, verse 26. The Bible says, if anyone considers himself religious, you know, I don't consider myself religious. That's okay. You'll answer to God too. You don't have to consider yourself to know that you're going to stand before God for judgment. If anyone considers himself religious, yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself. And his religion is worthless. Wow. Go over to chapter 3. James is my favorite book because he's blunt. He's just blunt and to the point. He just gets onto it. It's awesome. Love it. Then James says in chapter 3, verse 1, not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. So here's how it works for the crew super region of the City of Angels Church, right? So the day of judgment will come and we'll all stand before God and everybody will get in line for judgment. And, you know, James will be standing up there. Oh, he's getting it. Woo! Dang. I'll be in line. You know, you're all going to be in line. Here's the funny thing. Title, role goes out the window. We all stand in line. It's pretty cool. And yet, for me, he's going to say, yeah, scoot on over to this other line. In the world, it's the VIP line because you're the leader. In heaven, it's the you get more judgment line. Because it's more strict.
Yeah.
Woo, congratulations for all that leadership. It's awesome. So, don't think anybody's getting away with anything. You know what I mean? That's what should calm us here on earth. And yet, verse 2, it says, we all stumble in many ways. If anyone's never at fault in what he says, he's a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. We know that's talking about Jesus, nobody else. When we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal, right? Or take ships as an example. All they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they're steered by a very small rudder, wherever the pilot wants it to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue is also a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets its whole course of its life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. Wow. It says all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man, but no man can tame the tongue. It's this restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who've been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be.
All right.
Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? Can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? That would be actually pretty awesome to see if that could happen. Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. I love what he says here. Whoever is wise and understanding among you, let him show it by his good life. Okay. By deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. It's funny. Most religious leaders of the world don't spend enough time with the people they lead for them to see their good deeds. They hear them speak and they talk to everybody and they tell them how to live and what to do, and nobody knows how they live. I'm so grateful we don't live in a church like that. I'm so grateful you guys get to come and be in our home and be with us, and I'm in my leader's home and I know them and they know me, and we've told each other our life stories. I told a family member of mine that I confess all my sin. He's like, "You don't confess everything." Yeah, I do. "No, you don't. Nobody does that." "Yeah, I do." He's like, "Yeah, then you're like one." "No, I'm like everybody in my church. We all confess our sin. We get it all out. We actually do know each other." "No, you don't." "Yeah, I do." Like an hour of talk like that. Finally, he's like, "Whatever." He's like, "All right, whatever. This one day you'll find out." And yet, we should have this good life with good deeds that comes, it says here, from the humility that comes from wisdom. "But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast about it and deny the truth. That wisdom doesn't come from heaven." But verse 17, it says, "But the wisdom from heaven," right, "produces words from heaven."
That's it.
So the wisdom from heaven is, first of all, pure. So that means the words are pure. Peace-loving, which means they're peace-loving. Considerate, submissive, full of mercy, good fruit, impartial, and sincere.
All right.
Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. We have got to be those people who let God, through His Word, mold our heart so that we speak like God.
Yeah.
See, young men want to speak, they want to be like the wrath God. "Oh, I'm going to just put it down." No, that's not how God talks all the time. That was not how Jesus talked all the time. Most of his interaction with people came in a small setting where he was very gentle, very loving, and it gave great instruction that was very helpful for them. We've got to live lives where we are interacting with each other in this way so that the world can see what it's supposed to be like. Here's the funny thing. You go, "Thank God I'm not a teacher. Woo! I'll leave that to the other guys." Well, here's the thing. Anytime you argue with somebody, you're a teacher in your mind. Anytime that you feel so strongly about something that you're willing to argue about it, you presume to be a teacher in that time, and this scripture applies. And so we have got to understand the principles of teaching. Go to Proverbs chapter 12. The Bible says that every careless word, those words that will be judged by God, is like a small spark that will set a forest on fire. And I am so grateful to be a part of God's kingdom. I'm so grateful that He saved me from me. And in chapter 12, verse 18, a conviction to take on today. Okay. "Reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise bring healing." You know, our lives will go infinitely better if in the face of whatever we receive from somebody else, our words are always healing. You have the power to do that. You have the power inside of you to be under verbal and emotional attack and to keep your wits about you and to come up with a scripture from God that will diffuse it, that will shut it down.
Yeah.
Do you know 99.9% of angry people on the planet that are yelling can be diffused with a nice word, just a nice phrase from the Bible? I saw on Facebook, there was one cool thing. Most of it's garbage on Facebook. But I saw this thing, and it showed a picture of a guy in jail, and he was reading his Bible. And it said, the schools don't allow young men to read Bibles, and yet the prisons encourage them to read Bibles. Maybe if we let them read it in school, they wouldn't end up in jail to have to. Yet we are about building the kingdom of God here on earth. Never once in the history of mankind has the kingdom ever been built with careless, emotionally charged words that come from hurt. Never has God's kingdom ever been built out of bitterness and envy and strife. That's why God says, rid yourself of them. Because if you won't, then you can't build. If you won't, God's kingdom stays small and the problems rise up. Move on over to chapter 17 here, Proverbs 17. It is impossible to be reckless and reliable to God at the same time. In verse 9, I love this passage. He who covers over an offense promotes love. But whoever repeats the matter separates close friends. That means just wanting to talk and talk and talk and talk and talk about the same thing over and over and over and over separates close friends. Wow. Verse 10 says, a rebuke impresses a man of discernment more than 100 lashes a fool. An evil man is only bent on rebellion. A merciless official will be sent against him. Better to meet a bear robbed of her cubs than a fool in his folly. If a man pays back evil for good, evil will never leave his house. Starting a quarrel is like breaching a dam. Stop the matter before the dispute breaks out.
That's it.
Isn't it interesting that it doesn't say, make sure they know what you feel and think about it? that's where we get.
Come on.
Yeah. Proverbs 19:11 says, a man's wisdom gives him patience. It is to his glory to overlook an offense. I want to talk about this for a second.
Amen.
How many people have had someone say something offensive to them within the last week? Raise your hand. Wow. So here's the thing. If in that moment you just overlooked it, you are glorified by God. It is to your glory to not even have to bring it up. You go, I can't do that. You know what's happened to me? No, but I know what happened to Jesus, and I know it wasn't that bad. I know it wasn't that bad. That doesn't mean I won't have compassion if somebody hurts you at all. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, when we say words like that, we need to stop.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that in the last point. And yet, we make such a big deal about what's said to us and done to us. And you go, well, you're kind of conflicting yourself, Rob, because at first you say words do all this stuff, there's so much impact, and da-da-da. Yeah, but there's this thing called the armor of God that we're supposed to be putting on every day.
Yeah.
And the armor of God protects you from the words of man. That's how you can get rid of the bitterness. That's how you can get rid of the rage, is by putting on the armor. See, God's armor isn't like regular armor. God's armor protects your mind. It protects your heart. It guards your spirit. It keeps the Holy Spirit inside, just ready to go to work for you. And yet, when we don't read our Bible, we don't pray, you go, well, what's the importance of that? Well, you know, I love my beautiful wife. And you know, we live in the same house. We still sleep in the same bed. We're getting like our 50s, and we haven't switched like separate beds yet. It's pretty cool. And yet, what if all day long I just didn't even say anything to her? What kind of relationship would that be? Yet what you have to do each day is you have to go to God, and you have to ask Him to get the armor. You don't wear it to bed, you know? You know, that's why Satan attacks your dreams. You got to go to God in the morning and you take the armor and you put it on. But if you don't go to him, you open the closet, there's nothing there. There's nothing to wear. And so when you pray, that's you talking to God, right? And yet the Bible says, be quick to listen. When you read, God's talking to you. And so we've got to feed ourselves the scriptures more often. And let God talk to us. Because his words create inside of us exactly what we need to overcome these things that we have in our lives. It takes a lot of emotional, spiritual strength to communicate the way God calls us to communicate. Oh, but if we will change our city. We will change our workplace. We will change our marriages. We'll change our friendships. And we will change this world as a light that cannot be turned down. Proverbs 24:10 says, if you falter in times of trouble, that would be an argument, how small is your strength? Wow. See, when it depends on you to build the full life of nurturing communication, I pray that your strength does not falter when that person needs you most. Let us find the strength to cool our words that are on fire. Thirdly, healing words. Healing words. Proverbs 25. We'll sit in Proverbs here in the next few scriptures. Proverbs 25 through 25, verse 24. Better to live on a corner of the roof than to share a house with a quarrelsome wife. Wow. I'm not even going to touch that anymore. Verse 25. Like cold water to a weary soul is good news from a distant land. Here's the thing about God's people, right? They're full of good news. I mean, if you don't have any good news, it means you're not paying attention to what God's doing in your life. Because he's always doing something good, and everything he does is for your good. And so, don't you love that feeling when you get with somebody who listens to you, who encourages you, who leads you toward God and his Spirit? You know, when I think of people like that, I think of Aleem. Where's Aleem at? I think of Aleem. Aleem is just like always up. I'm just like, how in the world is he doing? It's crazy. He's always happy. He's always fired up. He's just always happy. It just puts a smile on my face, you know? I think of Montserrat. You know, there's two people that just excel in having words of encouragement all the time. I love being around people like that. That makes me strive to want to be more like that. Go to Proverbs 16. Proverbs 16, verse 24. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul, healing to the bone. There is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to death. Why do I read that? Because there's certain things that we just think we need to say, not realizing the death of that relationship is coming if we keep going down that path. The death of the unity that was present before we said that is about to die. And, you know, sometimes there's a way of being like honest and real. A lot of people call it keeping it 100. And it just seems right to them, but it leads to death still. And I see people genuinely lost. Like, I'm keeping it real. What's the problem? The problem's you're yelling. The problem's the body language, the aggressiveness. That's the problem. But I spoke the truth. But it's supposed to be in love. You know? I know none of your marriages struggle with that, but, you know, just thought we'd give that to the single people. But then, you know, sometimes Sometimes it's just better to say nothing, you know? Proverbs 17:28 says that even a fool is thought wise if he holds his tongue. And yet, and that one's on the little handout here. That one's on the little handout. And like it says here at the bottom of the page there, Proverbs 17:28, remember the manner in which you say nothing speaks loudly. Fine, I'm not saying anything. Well, okay, you know, the manner of what you said, that said more than the words itself, you know? I had a situation that came up, and it's embarrassing for me, but I think it makes the point. I said that in the last 24 years, there's been 5 instances where I've said cuss words. And there was one time at work, and I was the director over 5 departments of this internet company. I had a lot of employees under me. And my customer service representatives were getting lots of phone calls because our email servers kept going down. And the guy that built the email system was one of the founders of the company. And many of you seen a funny video on YouTube called Bad Day, where the guy's got a keyboard and he's just like in his cubicle. And this guy was just like that. He went through keyboard after keyboard, monitor after monitor. He just throw fits. There's nothing wrong with this blah, 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 email server. And he'd just go crazy. And he'd cuss my reps out. I mean, I had grown men to just come away crying after talking to this guy. Because they're like trying to help the customer, and they go to this guy, and he's ripping their head off, and just craziness all the time.
Oh, man.
And one day, I mean, after years of self-control, I'd lost my self-control. And you know, I went off. And I was like, I am so sick of you, all this, please. And I said, you are never going to talk to my employees like this. Take yourself out and deal with yourself or do whatever you need to do, but get out of here. And stop treating these people like that. That's not really the way you want to handle it, you know. So I went out and dealt with myself, calmed back down. I came back in, and then I get a call from the president of the company. And he says, Ron, I'd like to have a chat with you about this incident that I heard happen. And we sat down, and I was like, I got my head down, you know. And he says, Ron, what happened is completely, utterly unacceptable. We will never tolerate employees treating other employees like this. I will never have something like that ever happen again. And I'm like, I am so sorry. And I'm like almost in tears. I'm just like, and he's like, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about him. I mean, if you of all people said a cuss word, this had to be the most terrible thing on the planet. And this will never happen again. He's taking 2 weeks off. He's taking anger management classes. I am so sorry that you had to endure all this. Oh my God, I was getting fired. And yet, I sit in the place, I sin greatly. I sin greatly. But we don't realize the impact of our words and our lack of words. See, he had seen me for years take abuse from different people that went off at work. And he had never seen me even lose my cool, let alone say a cuss word. Let me tell you, living in the way God calls you to live has its incredible benefits that you can't even imagine.
Yeah.
And everybody's watching you because you say you're a Christian.
Yeah.
Everybody's waiting for you to fall.
Yeah.
But everybody wants you to succeed so they can believe in the Jesus that saved us.
Yeah.
See, Jesus lived perfectly, he spoke perfectly, and he died perfectly.
All right.
So that you would be able to speak words from heaven. He did this so that you would be able to heal relationships that are unhealable without him. So that you would change your workplace. You would change the mind of your coworkers and your boss and your customers, your family members. That you would fix society, fix your life, fix your city. Trump thinks he's going to make America great. Only a true disciple can make America great. The worst part is everyone can see the anger in Trump. the bitterness in Trump. He's doing so many things right, but the things he's doing wrong are so obvious. But the demeanor and the hatred behind it is so obvious. See, a true disciple will change this city. A true disciple will change our country.
Come on.
Speaking words from heaven is what makes our country great. Let us choose healing words from heaven that build up and create the world around us that God so desires. You have the power to change everything surrounding your life. Lastly, point number four, go to Romans 12. As far as it depends on you. We get faked out by the phrase, it takes two to tango. We get faked out by that phrase. It's true, it takes two people to get into an argument. But it doesn't take two people to get out of it. It really only takes one humble person who's willing to speak God's words. You are not a victim, as much as you may feel like you are in so many situations. If you're a true disciple of Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit living in you, you're nobody's victim. Nobody can hurt you. Nobody can move you. Nobody can make you do anything. And the biggest thing is, there's not anyone on this planet that can send you to hell. Amen. Only God can do that.
Amen.
And His armor protects you from all those who are going to hell. In Romans chapter 12, verse 17. Romans 12, verse 17. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible. Now, the Bible says nothing's impossible with God. So, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live in peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Well, that would be like, wanting to do that would be evil. And so he says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Give him the water actually to cool his thirst, not to heap the coals on his head. See, everything in your life can be fixed by you if you will obey what God says. You cannot fix another person. We spend so much time arguing and going back and forth and back and forth, and we lose our cool, we lose the fruits of the Spirit, and we lose God's words, and it's all us. And then it's a mess, and we're like, it's your fault. And yet, I put before you, you can choose to inspire that person. You can't change them, but you can inspire them.
Right.
Can't change them, but you can influence them. In fact, you can even trap them with goodness. You can trap them with goodness. I'm not going to argue with you. I love you. I think you're awesome. You're not acting awesome right now, but I think you are awesome still. Is that so hard?
Come on.
The problem is, because God's not in charge of your life, you're the God of your life, so you speak like God.
Right.
You think you have the right to talk like God talks. And you just lose, always, when you take the place of God. Go to 2 Timothy 2. This will be our last scripture. As far as it depends on you, live in peace with all men. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24. Paul's last letter to Timothy was like Jesus' words to the apostles on the mountain before he ascended. It was the last thing he did before he died. And Paul spent so much time in his letter teaching Timothy how to break through the barriers of those he was not impacting to be able to get their hearts. And he says in verse 24, And the Lord's servant must not quarrel. Instead, he must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Those who oppose him, he must gently instruct in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. A servant of God, a disciple, a follower, says in verse 22, flee the evil desires of youth. See, the evil desires of youth is to speak like a child. And when you speak like a child as an adult, you get the results that children get when they fight on the playground.
Wow. Come on.
And yet, if you remain kind, then you also retain your ability to teach. So what do you teach? Right there. That's it. That fixes everything. See, we want to say how we feel so badly that we fail to say how God feels. Because how God feels will change them. They can only yell at you so long before they break down from niceness. And yet, we do that because we lose hope. We lose the hope that if we act right, God will be faithful and change their life and it'll get fixed. So we remain kind, able to teach, and not resent. We don't speak in resentment. And then we do that because we know and we hope that God's will prevail. That's what leads them to a knowledge of the truth. And you became the one leading the situation. And so today, I pray that you will. So I mess up my notes. Choose to teach God's word. You have to read God's word and know God's word to teach God's word. Titus 2 says, 2:1-8 says, that you are to teach in this way, soundness of speech that cannot be condemned. There's something to be said in every situation that cannot be refuted in any way, shape, or form. But you got to know God's word to be able to come up with that. This must be our heart. I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. I swear to teach the Bible and the whole Bible and nothing but the Bible. I swear to not let my bias or my hurt or my past teach me instead of teaching God. So help me, God. 1 Corinthians 8:13 says it all about our hearts for one another. Therefore, if what I eat causes my brother to fall into sin, I'll never eat meat again so that I will not cause him to fall. Today, if your word hurts somebody, never say it again so you will not cause your brother or sister to fall. As far as it depends on you, fix every relationship in your life. Jesus died so your words could live. Decide to rid yourself of these words on fire that tear down and destroy. Set your heart and mind on words from heaven that will get as many as possible to heaven with you. It's time for Jesus' followers to rise up in the strength Jesus provides. And to be the light that says, let there be Jesus' light in this world. And changes it for all eternity. I love you guys. Have an incredible night tonight. It's an honor to preach to you today.